You guys may be seated. Praise God. As we were singing back there, one of those lyrics just popped. It just made it was significant. It said, "The King of Kings calls me his own." Praise God. That's something to be excited about and to celebrate. Well, guys, my name's Panda. I'm glad to be here. No, that's saved down for later. But if you don't know, maybe you're new today. Yeah, my name is Ariel Banda. I go by Panda. A lot of times I'm up there singing and playing guitar, but excited for today to bring God's word. And as we open it, I remember last week, Jeremy, he told you guys to bring out your highlighters, your pens, and you guys open up God's word and you're writing it, circling it, underlining it. I kind of want to do that same thing today because we want God's word to speak to us today. And so if you have your Bibles, go ahead and start opening them to Acts chapter 4. Tonight, we're going to be talking about, hey, if you don't have a Bible, there's a basket of Bibles back there. There's pins behind the chair, so feel free to grab those. Guys, tonight in Acts chapter 4, we're talking about what does it look like to live and to pray with boldness and courage and how to live by the Spirit as we see God's glory and power being displayed among the church. You know, we've been in Acts this year, and pretty much what Acts means is we're seeing the early church grow, right? From Jesus and from the disciples, we're seeing the apostles spreading the gospel to the first century church. And we've been in different parts, but today we're talking about Peter and John and how they displayed great boldness by the Holy Spirit. And so first, I kind of want some practical maybe questions is, have you ever been in a season of life, has there ever been a moment where you have been required to take a bold or courageous action against something that was either fearful or intimidating? And the answer is yes, everyone. We've all had those moments, right? And maybe think about it. You know, maybe it was reciting your first speech in front of your speech class. Or, you know, maybe it was preaching Acts chapter 4 in front of student ministry. Woo! Anybody? Anybody relate? Well, maybe it was if you're a baseball. I didn't play baseball, but maybe it was the bottom of the ninth. Base is loaded. Your team is down. It's all up to you. You're facing the pitcher. There's intimidation. There's a little bit of fear, but it's a great opportunity to do something big. Or maybe it was yesterday, Valentine's Day. Maybe it was finally telling that significant other how you felt about them, you know? I know guys, if that's ever happened, your heart is just like pumping so much. Now we're getting serious. Uh-oh. Or maybe, guys, maybe it was an opportunity to stand up for your faith, yeah? Maybe it was an opportunity to be a light and a voice for maybe a struggling classmate in school, but maybe that person was outside of your friend circle, so, you know, there was some risk maybe involved. You know, maybe it came with the potential social cost of facing opposition, maybe losing some friends, or honestly just risking the possibility of losing the cool status amongst your friends. And if you're a Christian, here's the reality. You're going to face more of those opportunities to share Jesus. But the question is, what are we going to do with him? My prayer is that after reading and discussing Acts chapter 4 tonight, that we as a student ministry, as group leaders, as students, that we would grow in our desire to know Christ, to make him known, and to live and pray in a way that exudes boldness and courage amidst opposition. So you have Acts chapter 4 open. Let's consider the way that the apostles Peter and John, and later we're going to see the early church, how they responded when trials and fear and intimidation came knocking on their door. So if you get anything from tonight, I just want to put up front the big idea for tonight. The big idea for tonight is that being bold for Jesus comes from being with Jesus. Being bold for Jesus comes from being with Jesus. Does that make sense? Awesome. This is kind of a little bit bigger passage, so we're going to kind of break it into some parts. So Acts chapter 4, verses 1 through 4, I'll read it. It says, the title of this says, Peter and John before the council. Okay, actually, I lied. Before we read it, I want to give a little context. Your homework tonight is to read Acts chapter 3 and see how is it that Peter and John got in front of a council? Well, long story short, Jesus and Peter heal a man, and people witness this miracle of the healing of this lame man, And it opens a door for them to start preaching the gospel. And everyone's there. They're preaching in front of a multitude of people. And then in come the highly religious elite, the Pharisees, the Sadducees. They name some by name, Alexander in the text. They come and they stop Peter's preaching of the gospel. And we're going to see why. So, verse 1, it says, as they were speaking to the people, the priests and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came upon them. Some other texts say confronted them or laid hands on them because they were greatly annoyed. Other passages say disturbed or indignant or vexed because they were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection from the dead. And they arrested them and put them in custody until the next day, for it was already evening. But many of those who had heard the word believed, and the number of the men came to about 5,000. So if you can picture this, it's literally as if maybe, picture me, we're talking about Jesus, we have God's word open, and in come the big dogs, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the religious elite, and they don't like what's going on. For a little context, the Sadducees, Pharisees, even them, they were highly religious, but even they didn't get along. But sometimes another's enemy is another's friend, right? So even they get together to go against what Peter and John are testifying about Jesus. And if you know one thing that the Sadducees were known for is that they did not believe in the resurrection of the dead. So the fact that Peter is preaching that Jesus has resurrected really got some people mad, right? It says they were greatly annoyed. They put him in jail. They arrested them until the next night. But even here, we see some glimmer of hope. Verse 4 says, but many of those who had heard the word believed, and the number of the men came to about 5,000. Let's look at the second kind of vision of this passage in Acts chapter 4, 5 through 12. We're going to see, what is it that Peter and John are actually saying? Let's read. It says, on the next day, their rulers and elders scribes gathered together in Jerusalem with Annas, the high priest, and Caiaphas, and John, and Alexander, and all who were of the high priestly family. I underlined that. If you see there, that right there is, they're all who were with the high priestly family. You know, kind of intimidating setting. It says, and when they had set them in their midst, they inquired, by what power or by what name did you do this? They're pretty much asking, who do you think you are? Huh? Like, who are you to start testifying in front of this multitude? And let's look at how Peter responds. But let's look. Verse 8. Then Peter, what does it say? Filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, man, praise God, the Holy Spirit comes, that God answers at the right time. Who knows, Peter may be intimidated or in fear, could have responded, but Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers of the people and elders, if we are being examined today concerning a good deed done to a crippled man, remember that good deed, that miracle that happened, that's in chapter 3 that we didn't read, says, by what means this man has been saved, let it be known to all of you and to the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him, this man is standing before you well. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders which have become the cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. Whoa. What they just said is really shocking. They are literally talking to the religious elite. And he's throwing some stones. He said, oh, this guy, the one that you crucified, this is the guy that by which this crippled man is healed. Guys, this statement, mostly if you look at verse 12, it's a very absolute statement. You read it, you can't really say, well, maybe he means this, or, you know, maybe there's some wiggle room. Let's look at verse 12. It says, and there is salvation in no one else. Think about our context. Think about your context right now in school, at work. Absolute statements are not popular, right? Love is relative. Truth is relative. And, you know, oh, you can believe that. That's your truth. Have you ever heard that before? Maybe a friend said, oh, it's okay. You believe that, but as long as it doesn't intrude on what I believe, right? Whoa, that's not what we're seeing right here. We're seeing Peter saying an absolute statement, saying there is salvation in no one else. But even more, he says, there's no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. There's another statement. We must be saved. Not, wow, you know, we choose to, it'd be fun to. We, you, me, you must be saved. So what's the answer? Uh-oh. So we must be saved. I think we found who we must be saved by. But remember, the point of this passage is John and Peter and John, they're saying some really bold things in front of a very intimidating crowd. I don't know, maybe in your mind you can think of something that's intimidating. For me, it would be as if going into work and all my bosses and supervisors say, hey, we're having a meeting. And I'm going in there. Maybe for you, think of your context, maybe it's you get to school one day and the principal says, hey, can you meet me in my office? Whoa. Or my other adults, maybe it's, you know, who are the tax people? IRS? Oh, baby, IRS, hey, can I have a meeting with you? We don't like that. That's intimidating. Oh, man. You know, but in this context, this culture, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the religious elite, they were the big dogs. And yet, we're going to see, how is it that common men like Peter and John, disciples of Jesus, responded with such boldness and courage? Let's read the third part of this passage, 13:22. This is the root and the reason for the apostles' boldness. It says, now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated, common men, they were, what? Astonished. And they recognized that they had, what? Been with Jesus. I'm going to read that one more time. Now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated, common men, they were astonished. And they recognized that they had been with Jesus. That's key. This is key to the passage. But seeing the man who had healed standing beside them, they had nothing to say in opposition. But when they had commanded them to leave the council, they conferred with one another, saying, what shall we do with these men? For that a notable sign has been performed through them is evident. Is evident, inhabitants of Jerusalem, and we cannot deny it. But in order that it may be spread no further among the people, let us warn them to speak no more to anyone in this name. So they called them and charged them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John answered them, whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you rather than to God, you must judge. For we cannot but speak of what we have seen and heard. And when they had further threatened them, they let them go, finding no ways to punish them because of the people, for all were praising God for what had happened. For the man on whom this sign of healing was performed was more than 40 years old. When they were released, they went to their friends and reported what the chief priests and elders had said to them. We see it three times here that they were threatened. They were threatened more. Hey, stop speaking about the name of Jesus. Hey, we'll let you go, but this has to stop. And how do we see Peter and John respond? Verse 19. Whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you rather than to God, you must judge, for we cannot but speak of what we have seen and heard. In a lighter sense, think about, there's certain things that we're really passionate about, right? And I'm thinking about, for me, sports, food come to mind. And when I have seen and heard and tasted about something delicious, you can't tell me otherwise. I'm going to tell you about it. I think, man, I'm actually thinking about the last preaching I had. I think I talked about Torchy's queso. I always talk about Torchy's queso. But, man, when I have seen, when I have tasted the goodness, the torchy's queso. You can tell me to stop talking about it, but guess what? It's not happening. I'm going to tell you about it. I'm going to tell you it's better than Chewy's. It's better than Velvet Taco. It's better than even Chili's queso. It's the best. If you haven't had it, you had to have it. But a little, so that's, you know, we kind of understand that, right? When we have seen something and we have tasted and we say, hey, this is true, it's really hard to contradict, right? But think about Jesus and Peter have been with Jesus. They've been with for him for 3 years in his ministry. They were even sad and distressed when Jesus died. Do you remember in all the Gospels when Peter himself denied Jesus? There was fear in his life, and now we're seeing a different Peter, a different Peter that it's living. He's living with boldness. He's saying, "Hey, I'm gonna tell you who this guy is. I'm gonna tell you about Jesus because they've seen him." And since Acts, we're seeing. Remember, beginning of Acts, Jesus came back, lived with the disciples, with the early church for 40 days before he ascended. And the power of the Holy Spirit is filling these guys. There is power and there's boldness that's happening because of the Holy Spirit. And so let's think that and how that affects our lives, right? Maybe ask ourselves, how is it that, you know, we see Peter and John living for God in a bold way? Can that be true, or is that true of my life? Remember, the big idea for tonight is that being bold for Jesus comes from being with Jesus. So having said that, there's a couple application points that I want us to consider. And first is that, have you assessed your life in a while? Have you had time to just think about how you're doing? Maybe let's ask these questions. How is your time with Jesus? Are you spending time with him? Is my time with Jesus evident amongst those that I spend quality time with? How is it that we can say that people, how is it that people can say that they remind, that you remind them of Jesus if you're not spending time with him? Second application point is, how would people know that you are a person who has been with Jesus? What would be unique about your life? What would change? Would there be habits that change? Even your vocabulary, would it change? Would your conversations change? Would your routines change? I think so. And lastly is, as we consider these things, you might be thinking, well, you know, hey, I love the idea of being bold, but that's just not me. You know, God didn't make me that way. Well, if you're in Christ, if you're a Christian, you are indwelt by the Holy Spirit. And you may not feel that you have the courage or the desire or, you know, it's in your character to be bold. But what do we see from the passage? It says that the Holy Spirit filled Peter as he responded. And so as you pray, why not ask for opportunities to be witnesses for what Jesus has done and for boldness, opportunities for boldness to come up? If you still have your Bible open, let's look at Acts chapter 4, verses 29 to 31. Kind of summarize real quick is, we just read where Peter and John are in front of the council. They finally let him go, and they say, and it says that they report to the early church what happened. How does the early church respond? They go to God in prayer. And how do they pray? Let's read verse 29. It says, "And now, Lord, look upon their threats." Whose threats? The threats of the people with power, right? Sadducees, Pharisees. It says, "Now, Lord, look upon their threats and grant to your servants to continue to speak your word with all boldness. While you stretch out your hand to heal, and signs and wonders are performed to the name of your holy servant Jesus." And when they had prayed, the place in which they were gathered together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. And what happened? What do we see? It says, "And they continue to speak the word of God with boldness." That's an evidence, a fruit of being filled with the Holy Spirit. What is it? that they continue to speak the word of God with boldness. You know, this prayer, as we can see, is not a prayer for comfort, but it's a prayer for boldness, right? Man, I pray that we'd pray like that. So as we conclude, this week, as you come to prayer, spend time asking the Holy Spirit to give you boldness where you need it the most. Ask God to shake the foundations of your life. That's a crazy prayer, it seems like. But it says to show you exactly where you need to move to action and to be bold where it's needed most. Let's go to God in prayer. Father, we come to you tonight humbled, God, appreciative of the way that we've seen you work powerfully by the Holy Spirit through the apostles Peter and John, God, and how their boldness increased the faith and courage of the early church. God, we desire to be men and women like that. God, we desire to stand firm on your promises and declare with courage the absolute truth of the gospel. God, that there's no salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. God, we pray that each day you make us more like you, and that the people that you surround us with each day would see that we are your people. God, in everything we declare, that you would increase, God, and we would decrease. In the name of Jesus, amen.